The next performance rock star, it's going to be Andreas Gerstmeier with integrating and visualizing eBPF metrics. So, Andreas, first of all, Andreas, it's great because it's a new PAC member. So, welcome on board to the PAC community, Andreas. So, Andreas is working for Red Hat on the Performance Copilot and the related performance visualization tools. Before that, he was working for a consulting company called Catalyst, based in Austria.
Yes, so hello everyone. Thanks for having me. I'm Andreas Gerstmer. I'm working for Performance Copilot and Grafana, working at Red Hat. And today I will show you how to integrate and visualize eBPF metrics in Performance Copilot and Grafana. Let's start with a quick outline what I will show you today. So I'll start with what is eBPF, how to load eBPF, what is the verifier. Then most of the talk will be a walkthrough of a sample eBPF program, which is measuring the block device I/O latency with eBPF. Then we will integrate this tool into Performance Copilot. So with Performance Copilot, we can, for example, log the eBPF metrics every 10 seconds. And also it allows us to integrate the metrics into Grafana, so we can have a visualization in a heat map in Grafana. Last, I will show the same program with BPF trace to show you the difference. And I'll give a quick outlook on the future of the eBPF and PCC and BPF trace landscape. Let's start with what is eBPF. The eBPF is in-kernel virtual machine. That means it can load bytecode, like you call a syscall with bytecode, and the code is running inside the kernel, inside the kernel space. It doesn't require change of any kernel sources, and also doesn't require to load a new kernel module. And with great power, obviously also comes great responsibility. So the programs are a sandbox that's based on the eBPF program type. There are multiple program types, for example, one which is run which is run very low level on the network layer, another one which we use for tracing, which has more access to kernel internals, which is the one we will be using. And it's intentionally not Turing complete. So for example, you cannot have unbound loops, because of course, if you have an loop which doesn't end, then your system will stand like this. It won't crash, but nothing will happen anymore. So that's why before loading the BPF program, there's a BPF verifier, which checks if the eBPF program always holds. And that's why it's not Turing complete, because otherwise you could not enforce this requirement. And let's start with how, when an eBPF program is run. So usually you attach eBPF programs by hooks to certain points. For example, in this example, it will be called every time when the exec for a syscall is called, and it will get the current PID and the current comment name, which was on CPU, and it submits a Turing buffer. This picture is from eBPF.io, which is a really great resource if you're new to eBPF and if you want to learn how eBPF works and if you want more background about eBPF. So in this example, as we can see, every time when a user space process is calling the exec for a syscall, it calls the eBPF program and then continues with the scheduler code of the Linux kernel. And here we are describing how eBPF programs are loaded into the kernel. So the process running in user space, calling the BPF syscall with the bytecode of the eBPF program. Then it gets checked with the verifier, which checks if there are no unbound loops, if all the data access is approved. For example, you shouldn't get access to private keys of some certificates. Then once it's approved, it gets compiled to the architecture of your running system. And After it's compiled, it runs in the kernel. And then every time when your process is doing some syscalls and you in your eppf program is attached to one of the syscalls, then the eppf program is run and you can access, for example, the function arguments of the syscalls. Or you can attach to sockets, TCP, network, you can basically attach to all kernel functions. And now we learned how to, when eppf programs are called, but now we also need some mechanism to access the data which was generated from the eppf program. So for example, in our case, we want to measure the block IO latency. So we need to store somewhere every time when the block IO request is starting, and then at when the block IO request is finished, we need to check when it started and calculate the delta. And we also need to access from this data from the user space. So with eppf, we have eppf maps. So the eppf program can read and write data from eppf maps. And from an user space program, there's another syscall, which is reading the eppf maps. So eppf maps is the primary infrastructure, so to say, which how to share data between eppf programs and the user space tool. Let's continue with the eppf compiler collection. So writing manual eppf tools was a bit challenging. So that's why, I don't know, a long time back, they started with the eppf compiler collection. It's a toolkit for creating eppf-based tools. For example, it takes care of compiling the eppf code, which is like the C code. It's similar to C. It's compiling it to the bytecode. And it also takes care of loading the bytecode into the kernel, basically calling the syscall, and taking care of the managing the eppf maps. And it also provides a few helpers, which you can use in your C code, which then gets compiled to the eppf bytecode. The PCC tools are written in Python, and they make use of the LLVM compiler to compile the similar to C code to eppf bytecode. Let's start with the bow latency tool. This is the tool which will be, like, we use the same tool for the entire talk, and then you can see how it's from zero, from the starting of the eppf program until Grafana, until you have the visualization. So we need a few, we need to include a few headers. And then here we declare two eppf maps. One is in one map, we store the timestamp when the block IO request started. The key of the eppf map is the request. That's the Linux kernel structure when a block IO request is starting. And we have a histogram where we store the latencies. So in the histogram, we will have a logarithmic histogram. So that means we have buckets, for example, 2 to 4, 4 to 8. And every time when one latency sample fits in one of the bucket, the bucket count will be increased. I will show you this in a few minutes. So let's start with the first eppf hook. This one will run every time when a block IO request is submitted. It's quite simple. It's just taking the current timestamp, which is a eppf helper function, to get the current nanoseconds. Then we update this eppf map. We store the request as the key and the timestamp as the value. The next part of the code is the when the block IO request is done, we look it up in the eppf map. So we look it up by the key. If we didn't find it, that means we missed it somehow and we just return. Otherwise, we calculate the delta. In this example, we use microseconds. So we just, because the here we get nanoseconds and we use microseconds, so we divide it by 1000. And then we increment the histogram at the position, and for the position we want a logarithmic histogram at the base of 2. So we first calculate the logarithm of the delta and then we increment it. And last but not least, we delete the time step from the map. And here is the, so this was the kind of C code of the EPPF program. This C code should be in a Python string variable, and because here with EPPF text, we are loading this C code. And the BCC, the EPPF compiler collection, is taking care of compiling this program at runtime to EPPF bytecode and loading it into the kernel. Then we attach to kernel probes. So every time when this kernel function is called, we want to run this EPPF function. And every time when this kernel function is called, means when the block IO request is done, we want to call this EPPF function. And in this Python code, we want to print the latency every second. So we can just get the table, the EPPF map, store it in disk, and then a nice helper function on the Python side, which just prints us the histogram. And this example BCC tool is adapted from the BioLatency BCC tool from Brandon Gregg. It's on in GitHub on the iowiser/BCC repository. So when you run this tool, we see here the latency buckets, the count, and just the visual distribution. So this was on my system. You can see in most IO requests had a latency of between 64 and 127 microseconds. And here we have just the visual display of the same value. And so a quick recap of BCC tools. They're great for one-off measurements, but you need to SSH into each host and run the tool, wait for some time to get some data, and then stop the tool. So you cannot have continuous monitoring. But for that, we have Performance Copilot. So with Performance Copilot, it's a toolkit for system performance analysis. We have a lot of integrated agents where each agent is collecting performance metrics from a specific source. For example, a PROCFS from PostgreSQL database. And my talk will mostly be about the BCC agent, BPF trace, and also OpenMetrics. So for example, if you have one exporter exporting the Prometheus format, which is the OpenMetrics format, you can also integrate it in PCP, but it also works the other way around. So for example, if you have Prometheus already installed in your infrastructure, you can also instruct Prometheus to scrape PCP metrics, for example, from the BCC agent, which I'm talking about today. And all the metrics in Performance Copilot have metadata attached, for example, a semantics if it's an instant value or a counter, then a unit if it's bytes, kilobytes per second, type if it's float, string, unsigned int, and instances. Instances means, for example, if you have one metric, which is the disk throughput, and you have multiple disks in your system, each disk is one instance, but it's sharing the same metadata, sharing the same semantics. In our example, each bucket of the histogram will be one instance. So each bucket is one instance, and we have one metric for the entire histogram. So let's start integrating the BioLatency tool, which I just showed, into PCP. So PCP already comes with the BCC PMDA, which provides some easy to use hooks to load the EPPF program, the BCC tool, into the kernel to get the metric metadata, which is required for PCP, so it knows whether the data, the metrics are counters or instant values, and provides the hook, basically PCP hooks, so that PCP knows how to fetch the data. Let's start with the metric definition. So we have one metric, it's called disk or latency. And We use an unsigned 64-bit integer as the metric value, which will be the count in our histogram. There will be a counter, and the unit are microseconds. And this is just the help text. Then in the compile step, we load the EPPF code, which is the same code as I showed previously, which has the two EPPF maps and the two EPPF hooks. Then we attach the kernel probe. It's the again the same as before. Then in the refresh method, this method is called by PCP when PCP wants the latest data. We just access the dist, which is the histogram EPPF map. And we have one helper function in PCP which loads the histogram and stores it as PCP instances. Then we clear the, basically we have a local cache of the counter values, and we always clear the EPPF map after running, but we add it to the cached counter matrix in PCP. So the EPPF, the in kernel memory is kept low because we always clear it. And internally in Python, we have a bigger dictionary collecting all the counters, all the metric values. This is the method when PCP wants the actual data from one bucket, from one metric instance. So we get the key of the instance that's a PCP specific, and we just return it from the cache. And we fill the cache in this slide. It's this helper function is filling the cache. And that's it. Then we have, now we have the biolatency tool integrated in PCP, and we can run the PM info. It's a PCP command line interface tool with the metric name. The metric name in the PCC pane there was dist.all.latency, but to not conflict with other metrics of PCP, we prefix all of them all from the PCC pane there with PCC dot. And here we see all the instances where each instance is again one bucket of the histogram, and we can see the counter value. And now we can instruct PCP to, for example, periodically log all these metrics over time, but we can also visualize it with Grafana. How it looks in Grafana, it's like this. So we have one histogram with the time, and here are the buckets. That means it always shows the upper bucket bound. So this is 0 to 1 microseconds, then 2 to 3, 4 to 7, and so on. And in this visualization, it's the darker the color is, the less values are in one bucket. So the lighter color, the more values are in this bucket. Here we can see before and after the system was basically idle. And here between this time frame, I started a stress test on my disk, and you can see the latency rose. Here it's a big overview. This is another tool. It's a run queue latency, and this is the disk latency. And everything is integrated in Grafana, so you can select the time frame, you can select the refresh rate, and you have the histogram. But you can also integrate other metrics. For example, if you have metrics which are not histograms, just normal counters, you can also integrate them in graphs. And if you are irritated by the empty spots here, that's because the in Grafana, I'm rounding up all the second. The every time when the metric is fetched, I'm rounding it up. So sometimes, and if the interval is not exactly 1 second, when a metric is fetched, it goes to the previous or to the next bucket. Let's continue with BPF trace. So we've seen the there is a bit more involved in writing the EPPF tool with BCC. So BPF trace is another tool. It's a high-level tracing language for EPPF, and it makes it much, much easier to write simple BCC tools. Let's see how the same biolatency PCC tool, which I just demonstrated, looks in PPF trace. It's only, we have again the two kernel probes. So when the block IO request is starting, when it's done, we just store the current timestamp. Arg0 is the first argument of the kernel function, which is the struct request, as we had before. And when it's done, we just say we store in the microseconds PPF map a histogram of the delta, and then we delete it. So you don't need to declare anything beforehand. You just can start using PPF maps, and PPF trace is taking care of declaring it, and PPF trace knows that it's a histogram, and it's, yeah, like compared to the previous one, this obviously is much, much less code, and it allows you to create ePPF tools much quicker. We also have integration for PPF trace tools in TCP. So we have another agent called Performance Metrics Domain Agent in TCP, which loads PPF trace scripts from a folder, passes them for metrics, and just exports them as PCP metrics. So you just drop this file into one folder, and then in PCP you can look all the PPF all metrics starting with PPF trace, and you will see the biolatency tool. Like if you name this file biolatency.pt, then you will see metrics exported with a few information. For example, because the PPF trace PMD is forking PPF trace and running it, so this is the PID of the biolatency tool, exit code if it already existed, and the important parts is, for example, error if there's some issue. But here we have the microseconds ePPF histogram from the PPF trace tool. So we can see we named it microseconds, and because I used here include, it's a PPF trace PMD help function. Basically, it just tells the PPF trace PMD we are only interested in the microseconds ePPF map of PPF trace variable, because we are not interested in the start map. We only want the microseconds. So we can see here, data, we only have microseconds. And you can, it looks the same, just a bit unordered, but it has the same buckets, same values, and you can also visualize it in the exactly same way as the PCC tool. Now we are almost at the end of the presentation, so I will give a quick outlook. So the problem, or one of the drawbacks of PCC and also PPF trace, is that the code, either the PPF trace tools or the PCC, the similar to C language, gets compiled on the fly on the target host with CLang and LLVM. That means if you want to run PPF trace or PCC tools, you always need to have the CLang compiler installed on the target host, which is obviously a problem if you have, for example, an embedded device and you don't want to install an entire compiler. And of course, it also takes some time. CLang is a huge package, takes disk space, and it also takes execution time if you always need to compile this. So there is a lightweight alternative available since a few years. It's more and more people are starting to use it. It's the libppf C library and ppf core. Core means compile once, run everywhere, and it means that you can compile the ppf tool previously on your system, and you don't need to compile it on each of your target hosts. So compile it once on your local system, and you can use it on all systems. So the generated tools by this are, of course, much smaller. It's tiny C programs, which need much less resources than with PCC, the Python program, for example. And there's a big let's say movement, like a lot of PCC tools are already rewritten in libppf, so that we have much smaller C tools, which we can use also on embedded devices. So thanks for listening to my talk. We are exactly at 15 minutes after the full hour, and now we have time for Q&A.
My question would be, you mentioned that you're not able to do continuous monitoring. And I always wanted to, from the level of details that you're able to collect with what you just showed, I was hoping to find an approach where you could set it up and continuously monitor to get the metrics, send it over to InfluxDB or whatever it is as a time series database. So then you could basically collect and do some continuous monitoring that expose. So what would be your recommended journey if someone wants to say, I want to collect those deep metrics on my systems and report it back to do continuous monitoring to observe and to be able to make decisions if something goes wrong?
Maybe I wasn't too clear in the presentation. My point was with the PCC tools, you cannot do it continuously because you start it, you wait, and then it's done. But if you integrate it in PCP, then of course you have the continuous monitoring. So you can configure PCP, like the tool will run 24/7. And with PCP, you can configure it that every 10 seconds, for example, it gets logged to the disk. So with PCP, you can do continuous monitoring.
Got it. All right. So that was because I misunderstood it then. So now
the point was with the single PCC tools, which are not integrated in PCP, you just start them, you wait to get some data, then you press Control C to kill them, and then it shows you the latency. But with PCP, if it's, then you can, that's the point of like running it continuously.
And for the last version, the last piece with the new generation, which you don't have to compile the library anymore, the lib, I don't remember the name of the library you mentioned.
Libppf.
Yeah, libppf, yeah. So, which means I can easily package machines with the utilities if I have that library and I have a compiled version of the library. I can easily deploy it automatically everywhere. But then I can monitor lively every single server that has the utility, correct?
Yes. So the goal of libppf is that you don't need to have the CLang compiler installed because, of course, it's a big package, and it also always compiles the code on the fly to libppf bytecode.
Yeah.
And, for example, on embedded devices with less resources, you probably don't want to install Python and a compiler.
And by the way, there's a, in fact, it's funny that you mentioned this, there's exactly a question that just arrived in the chat, in the Q&A section. You mentioned about the impact on performance through the compiler or the Python library, whatever. Do you have any numbers on how it affects the performance? On if you have the C compiler or using the Python, what would be the impact on your system?
So the impact, like initially when you start it, there is it takes some time. But once the libppf program is running, basically you don't have impact of the compiler anymore because it's done. So it runs in the system. The metrics are they are aggregated in the kernel. So you're not sending all the data back to user space all the time, but it gets aggregated in the libppf map inside the kernel. So the total overhead of running libppf tools continuously is quite low. And Brandon Gregg did some performance experiments with the PCC tools, like a lot of them are written by him also. And if you go to the iowiser/PCC repository, on most and the help pages, he shows you the impact, but it's almost negligible of most tools. So like the biolicensing tools, because it aggregates all the metrics inside the kernel, the impact is quite less.
Okay. And something something I wanted to ask you. You showed us the Grafana dashboard as an example of the screenshots. How can I? What would be the because it was pretty much not clear to me how you were able to connect your data back to Grafana. So how do you send your data metrics back to a Grafana dashboard?
So in with Performance Copilot, we created two data sources for Grafana. So that's the Grafana way of connecting to some other tool. And if you run the PCP daemons, they are taking care of exporting a REST API, which the data source in Grafana is reading. So for the end user, basically, we have one plugin for Grafana, called Grafana-PCP. You install it, you connect it to PCP, and then you can see all the metrics of which are included in PCP. That's
And
the
so, if I want to, for example, let's say I want to, I don't want you doing on Grafana, but if you want to send it over, I don't know, a pure InfluxDB database, or if I want to send it over to, I don't know, for example, Stain will be the next presenter, and Stain is a big fan of Tableau, for example. I mean, Tableau can connect to any type of database. So it's a false question that I'm asking. But how can I change the data source, the target data source? I don't want to send it over to Grafana. But let's say I have another time series database that would be my central data source for any of my dashboarding. Is the change easy, or you need to have a specific plugin for that?
So we have for PCP different exporters. For example, we have one for Elasticsearch. So this one takes care of exporting all the PCP metric data to Elasticsearch. And because the ePPF, like the PCC agent, is we are completely integrated, it's a normal PCP metric. So all the stuff we can do with PCP, like in Performance Copilot, we have exporters for Elasticsearch, for example. So you can have all the metrics in Elasticsearch, which means you also have the ePPF metrics, which we just showed also in Elasticsearch.
Awesome. All right. Thanks.
No, it's amazing. You see, you have different performance engineering rock stars, and I believe that Andreas is playing completely different music than I do. So it's in a field that I don't often touch, but it's also really important in the whole scheme of performance engineering. So yeah, I liked your rock songs. They were really good.
Thank you.
Miko, do you have any questions for Andreas?
Yes. Sometimes I'm keen to happen what, example, DB2 is in Linux, and this PCB would work to monitoring Linux, which is DB2 instance running. So is it correct understanding for my? If I
Yep,
get
I
the
didn't
insights, what
understand.
happened? If my I want to see how databases are running, and can I monitoring PCB? That where data sources are, instance installation is there. Do you have more insights on what's happening on server side?
You want more insights of the DB2 database?
No. What's happening on server?
On the
Where
kernel
DB2?
side of the DB2 database.
Yes.
So I didn't. The current. Sorry. Can you repeat?
Yes, PCB is. Yeah, my understanding correctly. So it's some Linux Unix server monitoring.
Yes, it's an application, a user-space
Yes,
application.
yes,
Sorry.
yes.
Yeah.
And DB2 example is running on the Linux, and I want
Yeah.
to monitoring that Linux same time when I'm monitoring DB2. So get more insights Linux how it's working. So is that now? Can I fetch that Linux system data also during my testing with PCP.
We're talking now about kernel functions or the user space program, the DB2.
No, just a similar way when you are fetching data from Grafana. I'm interesting to put it in also with my tool to get it data from your PC.
Yeah, you can write like an exporter in PCP, but we don't have an integration with DB2 as far as I know. You can write exporters in PCP to export it into different databases. But currently, yeah, we have the Elasticsearch and yeah, the PCP archives.
No, I think Andreas. So I think the question from Miko was thinking is, is his product he has built a solution that monitor several type of database flavors. So DB2 is included, is one of the database that the solution is able to monitor. And he was he thinks that it'd be worth to also collect metrics that you're able to retrieve through BCC or eBPF, from what you showed us in the beginning. So if we could sort of collect those kernel data and send it all back to his own solution.
So you basically you can attach to any kernel trace points. So it's if you want only the it's basically if you want basically in eppf you can attach to kernel props, the kernel function of the Linux kernel, and also user space functions. So for example, if you have if the program you want to monitor is written in C or something, you can attach to also to the to all the functions, and you can also create histograms. So if you have the I'm quite sure you need the debug symbols and everything installed, then you can attach to all the functions also of your user space programs, for example the DB2. Or are you talking about metrics which are already exported from DB2? Like if you have an endpoint which already exports metrics.
Yes, I can handle right? DB2 and metrics for DB2 everything, but on system metrics on Linux, same time, that only. Yes.
Then I would suggest to create another agent for PCP. So we have one agent for PostgreSQL, for example, which is scraping PostgreSQL metrics. If you want to integrate it into PCP. So eppf is it's intended for like very low level kernel metrics. For example, the block IO latency I showed. But if you want higher level metrics, for example, like application metrics, I would suggest to use to create another agent which is scraping the metrics directly from your application, like DB2.
Okay, I need to check.
So yeah, it's mostly intended for very low level kernel metrics. And the thing is, also if you attach for kernel functions, of course, if your kernel version changes and you have in the new sources of the new kernel, the kernel function is a different name, then a eppf tool won't work anymore. So for that, we have you can attach to trace points. So some functions in the kernel are exported as trace points, which don't change over time. But like just coming back, the goal was like it's very, very low level for low level metrics. It's not really for user space applications, I would say.
Yeah, it's more listening on what's going on at the kernel side.
Yes.
And so,
goal of eppf.
Yeah, so you mentioned that you have an agent in PCP for Postgre. So yeah. Are you in that agent, you're collecting mixed of kernel metrics and user metrics from the database level?
No, in this agent, we're just connecting to the PostgreSQL instance and running some commands to get the PostgreSQL. The metrics which are exported from PostgreSQL.
Yeah, so that's
but nothing about kernel.
Okay. You don't do a combined agent that will collect in the same time kernel based metrics and pure PostgreSQL metrics.
No. But the goal is like in PCP, you can run multiple agents at the same time. So you can, of course, enable the PostgreSQL agent, getting the metrics from the database, and also enable a PCC agent at the same time to get data from the kernel. And then you can correlate these metrics in Grafana, for example.
And do you have the footprint of your agent? If, for example, I'm thinking just loudly, if I have a database with PostgreSQL and I want to monitor the kernel and all this stuff that at the end, maybe I will have maybe three agents installed on this machine. Are those agents generating any overrides or any consumptions that should be considered or not?
Yeah, like our agents, some are written in C, which have the least overhead. For example, if we the procfs metrics, and the BCC agent, it's written in Python and also it uses BCC, so it has more overhead in most in terms of memory usage. And the PostgreSQL, I'm not sure. Some are also written in Perl, which we are trying to replace with Python soon. But basically, it depends on the agent, and also, of course, depends how often are you scraping the metrics. So you can select it on a metric level, how often you want to scrape the metrics. You can set it to 1 minute or like 10 seconds.
Thank you for all the time that you have spent for this first tech event and conference. So welcome to the community, first of all, and I hope
Thank
to see you.
Thanks for having me.